will bow down, I will worship, I will praise you, I will worship, I will bow down, I will hear you when you speak, I will worship, I will bow down, I will worship at your feet, I will worship, I will bow down, I will see the heavenly realm. I will bow down, I will hear you when you speak. I will worship, I will bow down, I will sit before your feet. Almighty El Shaddai, El Elyon, the Most High. I will worship, I will bow down, I will hear, I will hear you when you speak. I will bow down. I will sit at your feet. I will sit here at your feet. And my eyes will be open. My heart will understand things great and wonderful. I will bow. I will bow down. I will hear you when you speak. El Shaddai, El Elyon, the Most High Almighty. Lord Jesus, Lord, we praise you. Almighty God, we worship you. I will worship. I will bow down. I will sit here at your feet. I will worship. I will bow down. I will hear you when you speak. And my eyes are open and my heart can understand. For the Lord has revealed himself to me. Say it. My eyes are open. And my heart it understands, for the Lord has revealed himself to me. Say it again, say it. My eyes are open, and my heart it understands, for the Lord has revealed himself to me. Take away the words, it's not right. You know, the other night I was just sitting in the presence of the Lord, and I heard somebody talking. They were talking about, they were saying a prayer that we prayed for so many years. A verse of scripture that goes back to the apostles, Paul's prayer, the prayer of the Holy Ghost. And I heard a person ministering, and they're talking about, I pray and I ask God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, to give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him. And the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and said, you have the spirit of revelation and understanding and the knowledge. You come to understand that you've been born of the Spirit, that you've been made a new man, that you've been made a new creation, that you're entered into Father's plan, the thing that He set forth, the thing that He determined so long ago. And now we live it. My eyes are open, my heart it understands. You have caused me to see. Hallelujah. My eyes are open, my heart it understands. For I have encountered the Lord. Lord, you've caused me to see. Hallelujah. Come on, just shout to the Lord. Second, the Spirit of the Lord is speaking. Hallelujah. Let Him speak through you. The great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God. The great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God. The great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God. The great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the Alpha and Omega. the beginning and the end, who was and is and is to come.
Hey!
You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the mighty God,
I'm not afraid.
Do it again. Your name is Jesus, Jesus Christ, Almighty God. Your name is Jesus, my Lord Jesus, Jesus, the Mighty God. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing of my Redeemer's praise. Oh, Lord, we worship you. We worship you. Lord, we worship you in the beauty of your holy. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Ah, mas que fratas. Mande o sia tu iu procum na mandre de bisiblo ton mana mene te vest. The Spirit of the Lord's been poured out freely. No portions given, but abundance of his life unlimited. Sure is for the receiving. You know, worship is for the purpose of you becoming beside yourself. Worship is for the purpose of you being turned into smoke. Worship is for the purpose of you being changed from one substance to another. As a sacrifice is set upon the altar, defines worship. Going from that which is tangible to the intangible, from the seen into the unseen. To be caught away in divine realms of glory so that God can begin to exercise his will and power through you and me. Oh, we have to break the barriers of restraint. We have to break the barriers of what we think. Our expectations have been wrong, but Father is here to teach us how to sing his song, how to move with him, how to dance with him. Ha! How to celebrate the glory of his goodness. How to move in signs and wonders in the splendor of his majesty. The word of authority that says and speaks it and it comes into being. Father desires to impress and blow away, to scatter the enemies. Because the heart of those who are blind and deaf and dumb to sing. Ha! Huh? To cause the lame to frolic like a deer. Yes, yep, yeah. And he's looking for a people who will draw near and be taught by him. Who will come into a place where all they want is heaven. See, it pares everything down. It's not about all these things that we make it. So many people are fixated on the sin and all the things that Satan is doing. Oh, but if you'll be captivated by the expanse, the unlimited expanse of his divine glory and will, the opportunity that you and I have, suddenly everything changes. The dimension of everything changes. You're not trying to... resist and stop wrong thinking. You're captivated by the right.
it's really on the same scale of in the garden, in the paradise. There were millions of trees, glorious trees, that were beautiful and good for food. And man chose to get fixated on the one thing that he could not have, that he was not supposed to have. Instead of being captivated by what Father has done. Tonight, in Jesus' name, I pray that the Spirit of the Lord will so move among us and move in your life that you will be forever captivated, raptured. Tonight, we pray that you will encounter heaven like never before. I pray in the name of Jesus, you got to lay aside your stinking beggarly rags. That human life, it's extinct. It's going extinct. The human existence and sin and all its iniquity is on the verge of extinction. Father wants to give you a regeneration. Hallelujah. Work hard. You can make it sound less. Don't do anything. This one's good. God wants to move in your life tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. You let him. Listen, just grab a hold of these things. I mean, Father has released some wonderful things into his servant James' life. You can have them too. It's not for show and tell. It's for show and tell and giveaway. Hallelujah. 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 See that God gives special anointings to his apostles, the prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers to show, to tell, and to give away. So that the church, hallelujah, can be built up, can be perfect, can be built up, can be perfected. If you didn't come to be perfected tonight, you are in the wrong place. You have not yet seen all that Father has available for you. And to do the work of the ministry, you see, the reality of it is the Lord told us to go reach them, to teach them, and send them. And within the framework of that, we're not going to just reach them. Somebody says, well, you know, the evangelists over there, they reach them, and the apostles, they teach them. Pastors, they teach them, and the apostles, they send them. Well, you know what? That sounds all wonderful and everything. It's the church's assignment for us all to be engaged in this. And that's supposed to be in every church. And that's what we're doing here tonight. That's what you're doing here tonight. Hallelujah. We're going to show you how to move in gifts of the Spirit. We're going to show. There's already been tongues, interpretation of tongues. There's been prophecy. Almost all of the utterances, gifts have already been in operation here tonight. There are going to be more. And the signs and wonders gifts are always there where the utterance gifts are taking place, because the word speaks and hallelujah. Healing takes place and miracles and signs and wonders. Praise the name of Jesus. I pray that you're here to be taught tonight. That you're here to receive, because we want, if we can't teach you, we might be able to reach you. But if we can't teach you, if we can't make disciples out of you, if you won't listen to us, if you're going to do your own thing, your own way, then you got your own stuff going. And it has nothing to do with God. If you're not living the life that God has commanded, then you're not right with God. And this is the way he set the program up. Citizens of the United States of America. This is the way Papa set it up. And he freely we receive and freely we give, but you've got to want to lay hold on that. And I just pray tonight that you'll lay hold on it. I just pray that you'll place a demand on the gift, place a demand on the anointing. You can receive from no person, including Christ Jesus, if you do not honor him and recognize who he is. When they dishonored him in his own hometown and would not recognize who he was, but falsely labeled him, he could do nothing there. And the same way, I've heard great men of God that's lived through the various generations, and especially over the past 100 years, say things like that the Lord showed them that all they needed to do was convince the people that God had sent them and had given them the authority to do his work in his stead. And one dear man of God who had one of the greatest miracle ministries of the past 100 years, God gave him a special gift of the word of knowledge to convince people that he was sent from God and that the authority of heaven was right there to meet whatever need they had. And, And those who would believe, I mean, my goodness, what happened? The miracles that took place. And I know tonight, I know that God wants to do it on a greater scale. But you know, I'm going to tell you something. In the 60s, a wave of rebellion is as though God kind of rolled back the restraints to some degree, and a wave of rebellion out of the demonic realm swept across the Western world. And the great signs and wonders and miracles that were pre-60s have not yet been seen again in the Western world since. And it's about time God's people shake themselves free of all those kinds of influences and begin to press into the servitude and the humility and the meekness and the brokenness that God demands in order for these things to be released and revealed once again. And that's what we're about. That's what James is about. That's what I'm about. That's what you need to be about. And so tonight I pray in Jesus' name that as James comes, you get your hearts prepared. Amen. We're going to receive an offering for him. Bless him tonight. And I want you to come back on Wednesday night. James is going to be here again on Wednesday night. And I want you to ask the Lord to bring you some locks. I want you to ask the Lord to bring you some locks, some locked up hearts, some locks. And then your part, if he brings you locks, your part is that you're going to have to pray and intercede that God would give you the key to unlock them. And I pray tonight in Jesus' name that you will not be as you have been, that you will refuse to have the similitude of men, that you will begin to walk in the realms of his divine grace. I'm telling you right now, when you engage heaven, then you are one whose eyes are open, whose hearts understands. You, the people, when the Spirit of the Lord has come upon you and the power of God has overshadowed you, you got yourself the spirit of wisdom and revelation. Now, Father, just waiting for somebody to move. Amen?
Amen.
Everybody put your hands together and welcome our dear friend, Pastor James Levesque.
Come on, how's everybody doing? You can be seated. Wow, so awesome to be here and with you guys again with my family this time, which is amazing. Can we give it up for your dear pastor and his family and his team? Honestly, dude. I think we've been to 50 plus nations. Well, I have. We've seen millions respond to the gospel, and often my wife and I will sit and say, man, where would we go to church? Like, I get bored, and I don't say that in a bad way. Like, we travel. I love the body of Christ. Look, we're planting 4 churches this year alone in Connecticut, Yale University, in New Haven. I mean, we're going to the roughest places. But when we ask that question, it always comes back to abiding place, and we're like, well, that would be our church. So I can tell you from the bottom of my heart, I love your pastor. He's serves on our board. He's a mentor, father, friend, all those things to me. And his family is number one in the country. I'm not just telling you this, friends. You are blessed to have a minister that fears God, loves God, and does not hold back. And, you know, his knowledge of the scripture is ridiculous. You probably don't even realize on a Sunday morning, like, half of what comes out of his mouth is passages of the Bible. And you just think he's talking. I mean, it is just amazing. But love you so much, man. Honestly, he's my pastor. I go to him when I need him. And many times he's been after meetings like this praying with me on the phone for things. So when what happened with Luke rose up, he was the first one on the flight to our church. And thank you so much, man. Love you guys dearly. Can I tell you, God is moving. Man, we're seeing God do some remarkable things. Side note, this might be the happiest place I've ever been in. Dude, I've never seen people smile. I realize that I just don't smile. Dude, I was born with a scowl. Can I tell you that? Like, when I first met Joshua, I thought it was fake. I was like, dude, his resting face is a smile. And I was like, he can't really keep it like, and dude, it's just everything. Happy, you don't even know. It's always that grin, and everybody here is like, smiles. So this morning, I'm sitting in the front row. I'm like, I don't even know if I could do it. Like, I tried, and it, like, hurt my face. But this is by far the happiest place, man. You guys are awesome. You guys are awesome. And God wants to rock San Diego. And God wants to pour out his power in unprecedented ways, you know. I think as a whole, I mean, obviously you are pro everything I'm going to say, but as a whole, people run from hard areas. You know, I remember we had a friend, Heidi Baker, at our church last September, and man, she's just helped transform Mozambique for the God. I mean, there was nobody there. And I just asked her, I said, why did you go? You know, I mean, when she went there, there was no white people. It was just, you know, burning Red Cross trucks. And I was waiting for this crazy angelic visitation. You know, I mean, the nation is transformed because of her. And it's so funny, she said to me, she said, we were at home and my husband was on the computer and CNN did a story and said, it's official, Mozambique is the most war-torn place in the world. And they turned around to each other and said, why don't we just go there and just bring Jesus to these people? It was it, not a prophetic word, not a crazy angel. And as two people are negotiating in a bedroom, a whole nation is waiting in the balance just for you to say yes. And one thing that, you know, Brother Yoon, your pastor, all the, man, you run to the hard places. Everybody wants to retreat and go where it seems easy. And let me tell you, New England is one of the least churched regions of North America. And we are going into that might as well be a mission field. And we're seeing God break out. And you're going to see on greater levels here. But places that people are writing off, you know, you're so un-California. Do you get this? Like, you're an anomaly, dude. Like, your beliefs, or I should say you are California. You know what I mean? But to even have something that is so radical for God in this hour is so needed. And I believe only the breath of God is going to breathe in greater measures, which is even hard to comprehend, but it's going to happen. You know, we went to Quebec City a few months ago. In Quebec City in Canada, it's like 0.01% evangelical. And it's not like the rest are, you know, Catholic. It's like the rest are nothing. The rest are atheists. They had like no belief in God. So it is worldwide one of the least believing places on the planet. And, you know, they're French speaking and they wanted, there's like one Holy Spirit little church, man, that, you know, I could probably fit this little section in. And the Lord was like, I want you to go to the roughest places because I'm going to demonstrate my power. And dude, we went, and I'm telling you, I said, look, I want you to bring every sick person you can because there's going to be no answer. They're skeptical, they're cold, they're religious, it's Quebec. But I said, Jesus will move in the hardest areas on the planet. And man, we saw God break out. I mean, there was a woman that had MS in a wheelchair because I just said, just bring every, I told him, I gave him notice. And I mean, I said, bring every single person. This old woman, cranky looking thing. Like, I mean, just rah. She comes up in a wheelchair and she couldn't move and she had MS. And I just said, look, put the camera on her. Let's do this thing. Because listen, darkness only means light's going to overtake it. So the level of darkness is just giving me greater hope. You know what I mean? Because darkness, no matter how dark it is, light will always win. And I said, look, this is what these people need. If Jesus is going to be known in this place, then we're going to see miracles and notable ones. And we prayed over this lady, man. She starts like grunting. And I just commanded her to rise up. This woman rises up, runs around the room completely healed. I mean, she could not even move. It was amazing. At the same time, there was a woman that had like, I don't know, dementia or something. She lost her mind, basically. Didn't know anybody for like 5 years. Didn't even speak. And as this miracle is taking place, this woman is watching her and all her family members are around her. And I just went up and started laying my hands on her head and I just started praying in the Holy Ghost. And all of a sudden, after about 3 minutes, I mean, it was pretty awkward. I mean, we're just all sitting here having a prayer meeting. Her family's behind her. In about 3 minutes, I'm praying in the Holy Ghost and she starts speaking in tongues. It was the first utterance that family's heard from her in like years and years and years. They all freaked, then it just snaps. I mean, it was like immediate countenance change. And she looked around and started greeting her daughter and her loved ones. It was beautiful. It was honestly amazing. But it's areas that people write off, you know, or think that is just have gone too far or just have sold out to secular Christianity that God is going to invade. And you know, you don't need to be reminded, but the recipe for awakening is in this house, and it's in you and the songs that you sing and all that you do, you know. And I believe tonight the Lord is going to release keys to you for personal breakthrough. You know, what's easy to do is camp around a gift or a family or somebody that's super anointed like your pastor is. But if I tell the church all the time, look, if you're not thriving, then we can't go where we need to go. An abiding place just can't be one family thriving. I'm talking about every area of your life. Stretching and believing, being possessed with a promise, contending in your everyday life. Because it's so, the fire is so hot that it's easy to camp around and watch. But if you're not every day of your life consuming the word and living for God and going for the things of the supernatural, then this whole ministry can't move forward. Because it's all of you. Do you hear what I'm saying? Now I got quiet. All the smile people, stop. The danger is just honoring one and not you receiving it. You know, Gallup did a poll years ago in the 90s of all the mega churches. They called it 2,500 and above. And what they realized is they're great orators, great teachers, great staff, great, you know, everything. But the one thing they all had in common, this is what the poll said, is the platform failed to relay Christ's life to the main church. And here's what they mean. People were walking out of here not living for God. They were hearing a message saying amen, but their personal lives weren't changed. And I'm not saying that's you, but I do want to encourage you and challenge you that let it be you. Let your life absolutely be set free by this message so that flames of fire can be sent out. This is a mission center all over the nations. God wants to use you. Come on. The same way he's used your pastor and his family. You know, in a way, you know, my son was born, you know, basically the natural, they said he couldn't hear. And of course, we curse that and believe for a miracle. In the natural, though, we had to go forward in a process for him to have access to sound and you know, was not an intrusion of our faith. We pray every day and thank God for a miracle that he's going to do acoustically in my son's ears. But without any natural intervention, he just wouldn't have access to speech tones without a miracle. And so we had to give him access naturally to sound. But, you know, even then, to do a surgery on a kid that's 6 months old, I mean, his skull isn't formed. And it's basically like brain surgery to a degree, right? They're implanting something and they're doing, you know, these cochlear implants. And in itself was you had to be led by God because you don't want anybody cutting in your kid. And I said to my wife, I said, well, I need to know on the whole planet who the number one person is that can do this. And I ended up being a brain surgeon at NYU. His name's Dr. Rowland. But I really was skeptical. So I trust God, but I was going to just put my kid in anybody's hands. You know what I mean? And so we prayed and researched. And everyone in the world, hands down, said there's nobody better than this guy. We paid for it. I mean, it didn't matter. There wasn't a cost that I could have paid. I would have done anything. Like to the point where on surgery day, he came in and he was late. And he was like, oh, I'm so sorry. There was a 14-year-old boy that had a tumor on his brain and he was dying. And my colleague couldn't save him, and so he called me in, and I cut the tumor out and saved the life. Like, that kind of stuff. Like, that's not everyday life, you know what I mean? And it is weird, because, you know, you have to be a little nerdy to be a brain surgeon, you know what I mean? Like, you spend you don't really go on Facebook if you're a brain surgeon. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you're busy with other things that matter. But I was going on YouTube and I was checking out a clip of him doing brain surgery, and I'm not watching it because that kind of makes me wheezy, but he was interviewing about the subject of brain science. And he said something that was so moving to me. He looked at the camera and he goes, you know, and he's not a cocky, loud guy. As you imagine, he's like a neuro nerd. I mean, that's how he's successful. And someone in the back liked that one. But he said this on YouTube. He said, you know, there's times that when I go into a brain to operate, that I get thoughts. You're not qualified to be here. You don't deserve to be operating on something like this. Who do you think you are? You should not, you have no right to touch something like this. And he goes, and immediately when those thoughts come in, I tell myself, there's nobody better qualified on the planet to be in this brain right now. And if I don't operate on this brain, then this medical advancement will not move forward. And you know, I feel like with the things of the gospel, as a whole, friends, the enemy has tried to silence the signs and wonders Pentecostal movement. You get it here, but you're in a little bit of a petri dish. Because across the nation, this isn't popular. And when I'm around your pastor, I feel stirred even deeper for the things of God. And I feel like if we don't push this forward, then this gospel will not advance. And you have an obligation to this world to preach the gospel with signs and wonders, to be possessed with a promise that the things of this world mean nothing. I mean nothing. Nothing. This world has nothing to offer you. And it only matters what we do for eternity in the kingdom. That's the only thing that matters. And if we seek those things, then we'll have everything that this life would want. But man, this world's going to leave you empty. The only thing that's going to satisfy you is living for what your godly purpose was on this earth. And it wasn't to work. It's not just your clothing business. Don't be fooled by those things. They're only there to aid what you're really called to do on this planet, and that's to preach the gospel. That's to be a light, to see souls saved and regions transformed and cities completely transformed. There's no other way to live. And God's given us the grace to be in a hard area. We feed 100 homeless every day, Monday through Friday, and all drug addicts. And every week we're laying hands on these people. A couple weeks ago, we saw somebody set free from heroin, and they so got excited that they literally wanted to go out and start laying on other people's heads to be set free from heroin. I'm like, let's do it. I don't care if you're 24 hours free. We gonna go get some stuff done. Come on, man. And so we're seeing God do remarkable things. We're seeing generations raised up, and you know, now, like I said, New London and our beautiful church building that your pastor's come and preached in. He'll be here again with us in October. And Brother Yoon, I'm so excited he connected with to come to our church. And we got a great building and all those things. And now we're in New Haven. And, you know, we're there's a center of humanism there. You know, Yale University, MIT, Harvard. Dude, I don't have a GED. And it would be just like God to put his hand on somebody that has no education, but has been trained in the things of the Spirit and have the gift of faith in his life to see those universities shaken by for the gospel and that hard area touched by God's power. I was with a pastor that, you know, there's 2-3 churches we're planting intentionally, and then a few just, you know, staff members just catch the fire and they go plant churches. So one of those men was meeting with me recently, and I father all these church plants, and he sat with me and he wanted to meet. We met and we were having breakfast, and I have a limited time, and I knew that he's going to ask lots of questions, and I'll help him. And I thought it was going to be about structuring church and leadership. I'm excited, right? Just ask me questions. I'm at my best when I'm firing off, and you know, and he asked, where he brought conversation was, I never couldn't believe you would ever go there. And he sits down with me and he's telling me how God's touching the church and how it's growing. He's setting up leaders. And then he says this, he says, there's somebody in the church with lupus. I said, okay, I'm thinking, do you want me to go lay hands on her? What are we even saying? He said, and she's been prayed for by everybody under the sun. They believe for healing. They're going after it. And he said, and she's not healed. And he says, I just don't understand why she's not healed. And dear God, I thought, if the preachers are asking these questions, man, we're in trouble. Right. If we've not reconciled faith, right. Look, God's not on trial. He's not. Do you understand me? Yeah. It's this side of heaven always. Yeah. And what I've realized is, it's always, you know, there was somebody who lost their child. They laugh in the face of God. Their parents serve God, but they didn't serve God. They had a horrible situation happen with 2 kids that were born and one died. And he almost shook his fist at God and walked away even further because you didn't even serve God. Look, we can't negate the promises of God. Or as believers, let me put it this way. You don't learn through trauma. It always seems like it's when the emergency comes that we all of a sudden want to have great faith. Or then we get angry at God when we don't live a life filled with the Word of God. We don't confess the Word of God. We don't stand on healing. We don't believe it when it's not needed. But But then when it comes, we just expect this, like, this thing to rise up. That's not how this thing works. There's an abiding faith that God has given us. And that word is actually ever-increasing faith. It's a muscle that needs to be, you know, I like eating more, but I like lifting weights. And if I don't go to the gym for a while, if I'm working out, if I'm doing my biceps, I would naturally go to maybe 40, you know, 45. I'm not even a muscle guy. Just that's what feels good to lift. If I've not been in the gym in a while, I have to start at 15 and maybe do 20 for the first day. Maybe in a couple weeks, I'm at 25. Why? It's a muscle that lost its strength. Faith is a muscle. But you can't not exercise a muscle and then demand yourself to lift 100 pounds and blame God.
Right.
It's an abiding faith in you that leads to the gift of faith.
Right.
So it's every day believing the promises, standing on his word, praying for your coworkers that are sick, praying for any miracles, standing on his word, believing God for the victories in your life, which grows the faith in your life. Then so here's how this works. Say you have $1,000 abiding faith. You're living in the realm of faith in your everyday life, in your family, whoever you pray for, and say you get a $10,000 need. The gift of faith will kick in and cover the $9,000 to cover the $10,000. Does that make sense?
Sure.
That's how the gift of faith works. And then you may fall back to $2,000. You don't stay there necessarily. That's why it's a gift of faith. It's really, your pastor would preach a lot better than me, but it is listed differently in the Bible. A gift of faith and then the abiding faith. But we don't even activate our abiding faith. We don't exercise that muscle. On Sundays maybe, but I'm talking about every single day of your life, everywhere you go, living a life of the miracle mandate. Finding darkness and overcoming it. Looking, you know, where is the enemy trying to rob, steal, kill, and destroy? Go solve that. You know, we live in a day where, and especially the church is being more silent because nobody wants to be offended. If you make anybody uncomfortable today, you're a bigot, a racist, and the church is even more silent because you don't want to offend anybody. I'm telling you, we offend God if we don't step out and dare to dream on the supernatural. And so if you're ever even asking why, you're not even, you've already missed the train, dude. I'm so consumed with his presence that I wouldn't even ask those dumb questions. The word always works, always. It's not even a question. And if something ain't worked out on our timeline, then it's this side of heaven and we go after it even further. But it's almost like we're looking for a back door to not believe. You know, in John 5, it's the pool, the man at the pool of Bethesda, and Jesus said, do you want to get well? He ended up getting healed. Well, here's the fact. There were probably hundreds, if not thousands, of people around the pool, and one guy gets healed. The scripture focuses on the miracle that Jesus did. If it would have happened today, the church would have rushed to the thousand that didn't get healed and asked him how it felt for Jesus to pass them up. It's almost like we're looking to discredit the word instead of looking at what God is doing, giving him thanks for that, and contending and going after which we have not seen
That's
yet.
Good. Yeah. That's good.
But if you want a back door, you're going to have it. No people of faith talk like this.
That's good.
And I don't care who's laid hands on you for whatever. We have to stop attaining things in the natural and calling it the Lord. I'm so tired of the church claiming it's the anointing when it's the Kiwanis Club up the road is doing the same thing. People come to our church and they love our building almost like they worship the thing, man. And it's like, it's a building, dude. The Satanists could have bought it. You follow what I'm saying? Why are you giving, we are so desperate to give man-made credit. That's not the credit I want. I want to go for the things that your business partners can't do. I want to go after the things that you can't write off in the natural. Hello. That's what we're after. It's those things that take place where we're not even wondering if it's God. Where it's not even a chance. It's causing people to scratch their heads and say, that has to be God. I was telling Pastor Mark the other day, you know, we got in the building and there were all these, you know, heroin groups and like NA meetings and they're all meeting in our church. And it's like they weren't paying me rent. And so I was like, what is going on here? I mean, I don't even believe in this dumb stuff. Do you know what I mean? So I like, and I'm, I mean, they already had existing contracts, so I had to be cordial. But I went to them, I said, look, you don't even pay anything. And let me tell you, the winter gets cold. I mean, here, I don't know if you ever turn anything on, but I'm just saying, it's $1,000 a Sunday to heat my church, just in the sanctuary. So, I mean, it costs a little bit. And I said, look, you're not even paying anything. You're going to give me money or you're going to be on the street. And I went to the next group. You're not giving me anything either. I want $25 a week. And that's cheap. You better pay something. I know all you little crackheads are coming together taking offering. I don't know what you're doing with the money, but you're about to put it in my pocket or you're not going to be in my building. And I went right down. You're way too happy for me. And I went right down. You wave at each other. While we're driving today, all these people waving like, Deb, you don't know them. Don't wave at them. And it's my issue. And so, like, I went to the AA guy, and I'm like, look, if you don't start paying me, and the dude, like, chucked out 3 months in advance. He's like, please don't kick us out. Well, one by one, I started dropping all the meetings. I'm like, you go find somewhere else to go. You go under a tree. And I don't even like what you do to my floor, so just get out of here. Do you know what I mean? So I kicked all these people out. Well, at the same time, a bad batch of heroin came into our city. It's tragic. All these people started dying and overdosing on drugs. So now they're trying to say it was my fault that all these people are dying because I kicked them all out of the church and now they're all overdosing. And so there's one, all these people write me hate mail, they're angry at me. And then one guy, I had to respond because he wrote me a letter and he's ripping me and my brother died and blah, blah, blah. And who do you think you are? And then he signed off, you know, we're engaging Heaven Church. He signed off going, I hope you're engaging heaven because no one on earth likes you right now. So I thought it was witty enough. I responded. And out of that response, the newspaper, the TV came. They were like, you know, so then they wanted to write a story. And they went to the pastors, conveniently me, and they wanted to know, what is your role in this epidemic? Now, we all don't want to address the fact that I kicked them all out on the street and they have nowhere to meet. So now they want to know my role. And I said, perfect. Let's just kill it all with one stone. Come, I'll do your article and your interview. We'll all do it in my office. So all these people come in and they're all sitting down. They want to know my role. And I said, look, right off the bat, I want to apologize to all of you because you've been horribly misled. I said, the front of this building doesn't say Engaging Heaven Community Center. And it sure doesn't say Engaging Heaven, you know, city planner. And it sure doesn't say, you know, Engaging Heaven Narcotics Anonymous. The front of this building says Engaging Heaven Church. And in case you realize it, we're a church. And I'm a pastor and I believe in Jesus Christ. And that drug addiction is a devil that needs to come out of them. And I said, you tell all your little heroin friends, I was on heroin at 14, and go tell all your little drug addicts that my stage is filled with ex-druggies, and we've all been set free, and we'll never go back. And if you want to know the real way to get free, then I'll take you there. You bring them in the meeting, and I'll show them what freedom really is. We are not a community center. I'm not a charity. But we live in a day where you want to water your message down to be liked by people. Sure. I'm not here to be liked. I'm here for results. Yeah. I'm here to see the gospel demonstrated every which way I can. And when people see real freedom, what are they going to tell me? No, it doesn't work? Of course they can't say that, because it does. Are they going to look at us and say, well, you're not really free? Absolutely they wouldn't. Because we are set free, we're successful, we're serving God, and when I open my mouth, they feel it in their chest. And so I have fruit. They still have people standing up in meetings confessing they're drug addicts. Look, if you go to an NA meeting, stop. Just come up here and I'll lay my hands on your head.
Come on, yeah.
Honestly, man, you gotta stop this junk. I know that devil. I see people set free from drug addiction all the time. Everywhere we go. But you're not on this earth to be liked by your community. You're on this earth to make a difference. You're on this earth to leave an impact. You're on this earth to... Your pastor, I couldn't believe it. I say the hardest things. He came up there and we were just like, oh no. He gets the microphone And he starts talking about this wonderful church and how his family had history here and it was going good. And he's like saying, oh, you know, all the awakeners, and he's naming all the people we know, and it was going great. And then he says, oh, I used it all around the world. He goes, and all these people died and we know who they are. And he goes, but if most of you died, no one would know who you are. I was like, oh, way to make an entrance in the church here. Do you know how true that is? We have got to live that if we die, they know that we lived on this earth, that we left an impact and we made a difference. And they'll be talking about you long after you're off this earth for the great things we do for God. Come on. We got to develop kingdom thinking every single day of our life. Every breath we take is kingdom. Everything we do is kingdom. It's the last thing on our mind when we sleep, the first thing on our mind when we wake up. Living every day, unsatisfied by this world, living for the things that cause us to pound our fists at a table and dare to dream for more in every single area of our life. You know, that dash on your tombstone is going to be souls and millions of people that have been transformed. The Bible says the obedience of one, many will be made righteous. And we're seeing, consequently, on the earth, the disobedience of one, many will be made unrighteous. But I believe one person can make a huge difference and an impact and transform this region. And so this is a mission center. It's church planting. It's nations. And man, just pick a nation. Pick a nation. Give yourself to an unreached people group. Make a decision in this incubator that I'm just going to make a difference for this world. From this house, we're just going to make an impact in our region in San Diego. Lord knows how big the thing is. There's like 800 Snapchat filters for San Diego. I mean, how big is the thing? It's huge, man. You could drive hours and hours and still call it San Diego. Make a difference, man. Find a village on a hill and just break the thing open. It's not about, we don't leave it to God. You know, it's interesting that God never asked us to pray for the sick. He told you to heal the sick. He gave you a commandment to make a choice and a decision. And if we know, if the truth really is, grace enables us to do this. You know, grace in some ways is harder than the law. The law never required miracles. Grace tells you to heal the sick. If you think about it, the law just said, don't commit adultery. But grace says, even if you look at someone lustfully, it's adultery. So if anything, grace gives us a higher standard to live for and makes it the impossible life. It's the enabling presence of God. You know, there was a pastor that was doing a building fund, and he wasn't really a builder, but he wanted to help. And so he was like, what can I do? I'll do anything. Just give me a job. And they're like, fine. The guy said, I want 100 2x4s measured to 6 feet. Just can you cut them? I mean, it's not hard. He had a saw. So the pastor measures one 6 foot and he cuts it. And he's really excited. But then he takes that board that he just cut and he measures, you know, and he takes the next 2x4 and he measures it on the board he just cut and he cuts it. And he takes that same, the only people that work with wood are shaking their head, no, already you're giving yourself away. Then he takes the board again that he just cut and he's using it to cut all the other boards. Well, the problem was when he got to board 90, it was a 7-foot board. Because every cut was like an eighth an inch bigger. And it's fine if you do one, but when you keep doing all of them, it's only growing. So he's cutting it and taking that very fresh cut board that's already bigger than 6 foot. And by the time he gets to 100, he's over a feet off of where he should have been. We have to stop measuring the things of God by what you see around you. There is a standard that has been set by the Word of God, which must be our measuring one. We tend to look at things that aren't happening or, you know, we tend to look around at what other things are going on and that seems to be our measuring stick, but that's not the standard. The Word of God is the standard. So when we want to take pulse, we better go to the original. When we want to find out what God is saying, we better go to the original. Do you follow what I'm saying? Because culture will twist your head up, man. It'll make you think that, you know, smoke machines and skinny jeans will set you free. Dude, California's a mess, man. But if you're not careful, then you'll be measuring to a board that's not actually the right, it's not even up to code in the Word of God. But when we take the original and we take that and we put that on everything in life, like everyone takes pictures with filters. I mean, like if you actually don't, you're cool or like you're rare. But we can't filter the Word of God. We need to take the Word of God and we need to place it on every situation in life and realize that there's a remedy for it by the Word. And just because something isn't popular doesn't mean it's still not truth. And we can't stop preaching truth. And if anything, I believe a lot of the darkness that we see on the earth is a lack of Christians not doing what they're called to do. You know, they passed the weird homosexual law in Connecticut like 8 years ago. And now it's being passed on all these places around the world. And people are like upset, you know, when it got mandated. California fell right into it too. When it got mandated, all these believers are like, oh no. I'm thinking, oh no, it's your fault. Because you're not doing your job on this planet. Because you don't open your mouth. But when it comes to an election, you got something to say. Then shut up, man. You don't even have a voice. Nobody wants to preach the gospel. Nobody wants to talk about signs and wonders. Nobody wants to cast out devils. But we want to choose an idol for a presidential election. Man, that's so dumb. Your mouth was only made to proclaim the word of God. Your mind was only made. The Bible says, have no other mind but the mind of Christ. Man, there's not room in here for any other thought other than his. There's not even, we shouldn't even have a capacity for anything else that's contrary to what he said. I mean, in every situation of your life. And when we do our job, there'll be no room for darkness. Because we have the remedy. We have the truth. We have the power. We have the hope of this earth. The Bible says in Romans 5, in Abraham, in hope against hope, he believed. Not, there's earthly hope and there's biblical hope. And biblical hope is faith, and it trumps anything in this natural world. It's not wishing. Do you know what I mean? In the world, it's like, well, I wish. No, man. In faith, it's I know. That's your hope. It will happen. It's finished. It's not even, it's already done. And we stand on those truths. And that's really how we see breakthrough on this earth, by believing at his word. There's nothing that you're going to face in life that he hasn't already given you the ability to overcome. You've been made perfect. You're seated in heavenly places. Contrary to the demonic world around you, sin doesn't have to have a hold on you. It's not who you are anymore. It's not your nature. You've been transformed. It's a matter of you believing it. The enemy has no power whatsoever. Absolutely none. Bible says we're going to get to heaven. We're going to look at the devil and say it was you that did this. Because he's so powerless. And people give him too much credit on this earth. He has none. He's so scared of you. And the power in you and what God has called you to do. He's so scared of you. That's why he tries to keep many of you distracted. Was it Corinthians? Paul said some of the craziest things. He said, actually at one point he says, forgive me, I won't throw out chapter and verse like your pastor. At one point Paul says, look, if you're married, I would rather you live like you weren't. Right. And he said, not so to discredit your life or to, you know, for you to have harm in your family. He said this, so you would serve the Lord without distractions. That's powerful. Here's what's freaky, man. That dude wrote it how many thousand years ago? What in the world was so distracting in his day? Seriously. Watch out for the camel because he'll spit right at your face. Like, what in the world? Like, it's an act of faith that you're not all on your phones. You know what I'm saying? Paul wrote literally, live like you're single, even though you're married. Give it all to God and live so you would serve the Lord without distraction. If Paul is telling you, Paul, do you realize this? You even watch the Bible stories and movies. It's like, there's nothing going on, friends. There's no mall. There's, you know what I mean? What are you doing? Don't let your love for new sandals distract you. Like, what the heck are they even doing? I mean, what are they just saying? What in the world? But yet, Paul wrote, this is the most distracted day we ever lived in. Live like you're single. What in the world would he say to you now? Live like a monk? I mean, what in the world would he tell you? Go hide in a cave? This is the most jacked up, distracted day we've ever lived in. With more confusing voices than we've ever had. If Paul is warning you, then, oh, it's so distracting. Let's go after God with no, what in the world is distracting you? A woman? You know what I mean? Like, what? What would he say to us today? Friends, we need to live and serve the Lord without distraction. And we need to recognize the plan of the enemy when things come in our life that are delays to take up your attention and take up your time. And we've got to not put our face towards that. You follow what I'm saying? We can't listen. I'm very opinionated. I'm a natural dude. I'll fight you any moment of the day. I'm not angry. It's my nature, man. I'm not going to back off anything. But I've had to learn in my life to choose what I go to war over. Like, I'm not here to defend my name or to defend an argument. Do you follow? So I've had to learn it's not my fight. I will go at it for the things that matter. You know, Solomon, there was the baby and the two wives. Is my kid, it's your kid, whose kid is it? And they finally said, let's just take a knife and cut the baby in half and you both can have halves, right? And the woman that did own the baby said, no, go ahead and have her. Why? Because we've got to learn in our life when it comes to stupid squabbles and you just need to throw opinion out or you getting baited into a conversation that you shouldn't be in, let the baby go. Seriously, it's not worth it for you. I'm serious, man. But that baby for me is ministry. That baby is what I'm giving my life to, what we're serving the Lord to do. And if we're not careful, somebody wants to argue about a ministry, go ahead and take it. You could trash it all you want because I'm too busy focused on what I'm called to do. I told the church last Sunday, one of the major things that disqualifies you. I was talking about Nehemiah rebuilding the wall, God rebuilding the temple. And I said, one of the greatest things that disqualifies you is you wanting to be on someone else's place on the wall. That you won't even do what you're called to do right here, what's in front of you. That's right. We live in a day where nothing is fast enough for me. Do you follow what I'm saying? Yeah. A drive-thru's too slow. Nothing in the world... I'm bored to nothing in the world. I mean, I can't even get through a movie because it can't even keep my attention. Nothing's fast enough for us. But if we're not careful, then we're going to forget that this life in God is a process. That we go from glory to glory. That it's the everyday life that qualifies us for everything God's called us to do. We don't live like hell and expect heaven to move every day of the week. But it's like tithing, man. It's like giving. You honor God with your finances and, man, heaven breaks open over you. So if I ever have a financial need, ever, and it comes up because we dream big. And the minute my wife and I need something, I'm talking about the ministry, God to break, the first thing we ask ourselves is there seed on our behalf out there? And the answer is always yes. Because we understand how it works. You give, you trust God with your finances, you're a radical giver. And then when you need something, he's always going to provide. But it's that way in the supernatural. It's every single day yielding to the voice of God, living for the things of the supernatural. For when you have a need, you know it's going to be there. You follow me? It's not like, I got to present God with this awkward relationship, hoping that his grace can somehow help me. It's not how this thing was meant to be. He's not a genie in a bottle. You know what I mean? We don't just go rub the belly when we need some gospel goodies. That's not how this thing works. I don't know what belly we're rubbing, but... That's not how this gospel's supposed to work, man. It's a partnership of heaven. We give everything because he's everything. Whatever he said to do is what we do. And I'm telling you, this is the process of the kingdom. And in a day where we want it too fast, or it needs to be like now. And, you know, it's like, no, dude, we give everything. We live in the now and the not yet. We live in the understanding that he's given us with a constant push for everything he's promised we can have. And you know, I see guys around me, they're so hungry for ministry, so hungry for God to use them, but it's like, dude, they forget what's in front of them. It's like, no, you're not going to ever do crusades if you can't minister to the person in front of you. You're never going to set the world free if you can't love your family, dude. And it's like we dream so big that it's like we'll never do any of these things. Because it was never meant, you know. And I see, listen, I've been in the prophetic movement for so long. It's like it got so weird. Because everybody was addicted to words. But they're doing nothing with them. So they live with a keychain of like, well, in 88, I was supposed to have a healing ministry. And in 98, this one said that I was going to write a book. It's like you've done nothing with your life. You realize those aren't IOUs from heaven? Like if you die, you get an F on the test. Do you realize this? All your prophetic journal is doing is showing me how barren you really are. Do you know what I mean? Let me tell you something. Every time God gives you a prophetic promise, it is absolutely conditional. It is, you know what? It's an invitation. It is not guaranteed. It is an invitation on where he would bring you if you give yourself to the things of God. That word of God is an invitation. We somehow think we're walking around meetings like flakes cashing checks that don't even matter. I'm so stupid, man. It means nothing to me. I don't care what words you've had. What are you doing with your life? If God has called you to any aspect of anything, what are you doing now? When I started the church, my first church, I was 18 years old. Crazy enough, someone was here this morning that was there when I was 18. It was pretty radical. I was 18 years old. I didn't have, nobody believed me. I had nothing going on. And I'm like, what do I do? I was reading a book on William Booth. God said, if you could do anything and you knew you wouldn't fail, what would you do? Because I'm spending time with 13 hours a day. I'm crying out to God. I was dysfunctional. I mean, I had a kid at 15. I mean, you would have never called me to the ministry. But I had such an appetite for the supernatural and such a desire to see God just rock New England. And he said to me, if you could do anything in this life and you wouldn't fail, unlimited resource, money, anointing, power, what would you do if you knew you couldn't fail? And without question, I said, Lord, I was just reading a book on William Booth. And he said I would want to plant a church an inch away from hell. And I'm 18, so dysfunctional. And I said, Lord, if I could do anything, I would go to the same city that I sold drugs. And I was just thinking of bad things. You know, one time I sold crack to a pregnant lady. And I remember, and I wasn't even living for God. And I remember she walked away, I felt bad. I had a conscience. I thought, not only am I killing her, but now I'm touching other generations. And I remember that. And I said, if I could sell crack to a pregnant lady and I knew it was going to affect her child and I felt horrible about it, then somehow I can infect someone's life and their future generations would be transformed because of it. And I said, I would plant a church an inch away from hell. And I'm going to tell you right now, nothing. I had no education, never went to any of your classes, never had, I mean, it was dead. And the Holy Spirit said to me, let's do it. Man, I was 18. I didn't know what to do. I opened up the fridge and the Lord said, the way to kill a giant's not a slingshot and a stone. It's to use what's in your hand. I had nothing and no influence. And as you might have heard the story, I had a plate of food. I heated up. I went to the parking garage and fed my first homeless person. One meal, all the food I had. I was a mess. I was buying 99-cent double cheeseburgers, feeding the homeless every single day. Nobody knew who I was. I wasn't putting it on Facebook. I wasn't looking for your approval. I just wanted to make a difference. Whatever my influence was, and it wasn't big, it was homeless people. That was like the stretch of my influence. Then I was going to make such a difference where my influence was. And then, you know, God started breaking through. But, you know, it's interesting because we feed thousands of meals a month. We do a lunch, a sit-down lunch, one Saturday a month, second Saturday of the month. We'll have 200 people sometimes. We'll sit them down and we will serve them and then minister to them and just give them the touch of God. But man, we don't want to feed the one homeless when nobody's looking, but we want to be worthy of feeding thousands. It'll never happen. Never, not in your life it'll ever happen. Never, ever, ever. Success isn't accidental. You follow me? You don't accidentally plant an abiding place and touch unreached people groups and have a ranch in Oregon and change the whole world. That doesn't, you don't fall on top of that. That is years. Somebody in this family history, many generations ago, saying, I'll do it for God. In passing down the torch of revival and fire to a whole nother generation. And now it's going to go to another. This isn't accidental. It's like when marriages dissolve. I tell people all the time, look, it's never a blown tire. It's always a slow leak. You up in my office like you just blew a tire. You're a fool. There's been a slow leak in your tire for years and you've neglected it. Because there's no such thing in life as one great decision. And there's no such thing in life as one bad decision. It's always a series that lead you to a result. So if we want the success that God has called us to, I don't even like that word. If we want the fruit and we want the effectiveness that God has called us to, then it's everyday thinking. I promise you, it's hour by hour victory. It's touching ones when you're not getting the credit. You know, your pastor said this morning he would do it if nobody was here. I believe it 100%. You don't do this for money. You do this because it's, I can't live any other way. Because if it wasn't you, I'd be on the streets downtown touching someone's life. It burns in me. Never once in my life, never in my life have I ever written a sermon. This ain't a job to me. Never in my life have I sat down and was like, let's study for a minute. That's the dumbest thing I ever heard. Listen to me, because if you get filled enough, it'll just pour out of you. Because I don't have to wonder what God is saying. I can step in a room and God say, here's what I want to do. Because that doesn't happen in school only. Do you get this? It happens with an everyday walk with the Holy Spirit, learning to hear him and walk with him and learning to navigate and honestly, finding godly people in your life. Your pastor is not going to be a father to all of you. I mean, he is in a sense, but not one-on-one every day. Then get people in your life that have that are in this house, whether they're leaders or elders. Find people that burn for God and just learn how they think. I want to just know how this man thinks. That's honestly, that's no secret here. I want to pick his brain on everything in his life, his family, his finances, the way he views scripture. I want to pick his brain on everything he does so that I will learn to think this way. So when I need to make decisions, I know how to what I need to do. It's learning the real gospel and not just adapting your barrenness to around the word of God. No, I want everything the Bible says I can have. And if I don't see it, I want it even more. And I don't want to stop till I get it. Amen. Turn with me to Luke 19. I want to read something for the church that God gave me as a word for you that I believe is going to catapult you. See, most churches, that would have been a whole message. I'm at the Biden place, so now we can get into the main course. It's a well-fed bunch, man. You know, I live in our church and it's like, it's so interesting because you mentioned George Whitefield. It's like, this is a quick side note on healing before Luke 19. You know, these men, I have their notes on what they preached, you know, during the first and second Great Awakening that came through our church. And it's really radical being in a building like that, you know, but I read their notes and like you said, they're so limited on their understanding. But yet they had such conviction with the limited role they understood. You know, it's like the minute they thought being born again was something, they rode that horse to the ground. And they didn't even call it born again. They kept calling it the new birth experience. And they literally would be in meetings and they'd be like, you need the new birth experience. They didn't even know really what they were talking about. And conviction would fall. And they would tell people, here's how you get it. I mean, this is craziness. That you come to the altar and you wrestle with God till you feel a release. What kind of doctrine is this? All they were doing is being faithful with what they knew. They knew you needed to be born again. They knew that, you know, this Calvinistic don't do anything theory was like, no, you have a part to play. We are going to do circuit preaching and you're going to build your relationship with this God or you're going to go to hell. And these people would wrestle on the floor. I don't know what they were even wrestling doing. I mean, just praying and toiling and then they'd feel a release and they'd be like, oh, I'm born again. It happened. I mean, I read stories, bless these people's heart, weeks. What if you're that person? Honey, it's been a week and a half. I hope I don't die. I just don't feel the release yet. I mean, what? These poor people would wrestle in prayer all day and night just to feel a release. And you know what's interesting to me and what breaks my heart? Martin Luther included. Somehow the church picked up salvation and ran with it in a good way. Somehow we've picked up that principle and we've carried it through the generations. You must be born again, saved by grace, confession of your faith, you know, in many different terms. And now we realize that salvation is not this, it's very easy. You can be in this meeting tonight, not right with God, in this meeting right now, and say, Jesus, I want to give it all to you. That is it.
Right.
In that moment, you make a decision. I'm going to live for you. God, I confess my sins. I'm yours. I want to live for your purpose. And you're born again right now. It's that easy. I mean, even in the 80s, we like cranked up the wheel and tried to bring you through a prayer to make ourselves feel better. It's like this. It's faith. He gave a salvation call this morning, whether you heard it or not. That's exactly what he did. He put faith out there for somebody to go, Jesus, I give it to you. He did it this morning. He gave a salvation call. But years ago, it was 2 weeks at the altar. Now it's like, dude, you better just make a decision. You feel this atmosphere, give your all to it. You see how far we've come? What gets me angry is we didn't do that with healing. True. And we didn't do that with prophecy. True. That through the years, we've had movements of highlighted healing ministry. We alluded to some of them tonight. But the ball always gets dropped again. Somehow, really, can you imagine if Luther realized that in salvation itself is healing? That is what salvation is. It's deliverance, healing at the moment of decision. That's what salvation means. Can you imagine if they had a revelation of what salvation really was? And they were like, dude, it's everything. Imagine if that got picked up, we wouldn't be in this deficit that we see today. And I'm saying we need to pick up these principles and never let them go. And never let them go. And make a decision that my grandchildren will preach the same gospel and nothing will be dropped. Nothing. That we will see an era where nothing will be missing and nothing will be broken. To the extent that I don't believe Christians are supposed to be sick. I know that's not too radical for this house. Like, I actually don't believe there's even a paradigm for Christians to live sick. It's believers laying hands on the sick, not sick believers praying for the sick. It's a disgrace to the cross, man. And if because we tolerate this garbage, if infiltrates or like water, our buildings, water is a big issue. I mean, you probably don't ever get Wayne, but when it rains or the snow sits on the building, what happens is it'll slowly try to find its place to the least resist. So it'll find its way in your church. Leaks are a big deal in New England. And if the roof has snow and the walls have snow, when it melts, that rainwater will try to find its place into like the as low as it can go. And that's what unbelief does. That's what sickness does. It tries to find its place to the least resisted. So it's going to try to attack a grandkid. It's going to try to attack my son because it sure ain't getting to us. Please, the devil been served notice. But that's what rain does in your family. And you've got to put up a standard and say, absolutely not. When my son, man, I remember I was so angry. I told my wife, this is it. I'm going to pray for the deaf. I don't even need a word of knowledge. Every single meeting I go to, I want deaf ears to come forward. I was so angry. I was like, devil, you think you're going to touch my family? And it was like the first month, it was like 7 deaf ears opened. Every meeting, please, no word of knowledge needed if you're deaf, get up here. I was finished with this crap. You're going to touch my son? I'm going to kick you in the face every which way I can. And every time a deaf ear opened, I was like, ha ha, Luke hears. You know what I mean? Every time somebody was like, I hear. It was mine for my kid. But see, he wants to find the path of least resistance. Or he wants to build a theology where you accept things. Well, this person, nothing. If there's anybody or anything, you go after it right now. You don't ever let that stuff settle. You know, we were in a massive plane crash, man. In September of 08, it was right in the middle. We were in revival, traveling the world. I'll never forget, I was in Seattle. I had to go to JFK, then I had to go preach at TACF, then I had to go to Reading. I was like, and you know what? We're in a plane going from Seattle to JFK, no lie, the whole thing just died. The landing instruments, the brakes, all the power died, all the emergency backups, and we're going down. There's no brakes or nothing on the plane. The stewardesses, right? You know, they train you not to leak. Like, you go through classes, don't crack. If you're gonna die, you better die like the dudes on the Titanic playing the fiddle. Like, I pay you to fake it. You're gonna die with dignity. Do you know what I mean? And these stewardesses had no microphone. They were just like, all right, brace for emergency landing. Brace. So I grabbed this chick. I said, hey, this happened to you before, right? She broke. 45 years, this never happened. We're not gonna make it. She just broke. I'm like, chick, they paid you to lie. Do you understand me? You're going to fake it on the plane. Now you're going to break to me? I was like, this girl, man, at least fake it. Gave me no hope. Now I'm dealing with stuff. And the plane goes down. Clearly I made it. I mean, this plane hits the ground, fire, explosion, everything blows up. I mean, it was horrible, and we made it. I mean, this was like, we made it. But I knew it was an issue, and my wife is like all, you know, my wife is a pretty tough woman, and she's welling up in tears going, at least we know Jesus. I thought, hell no, this ain't how I'm leaving. I stood up on that plane. I said, everybody listen to me, right? You would think like the movies. Ah! No, everybody was like, there wasn't, I mean, you couldn't even hear a swallow. These people were like cattle about to be killed and they had no control. I mean, they just, like their spirit left their body early. I'm like, what is going on around here? I'm looking at these people like, you already died. I stood up on my seat. I said, no, this ain't how this is going. Seriously, I said, everybody, you stewardess too, I'm talking to you. I said, if this plane goes down, you better know you're either going to heaven or hell. Jesus is the only hope, and it's about, we're running out of time. This might be your last breath. This is your last chance to make it to heaven. I thought, if this is how, really, this is how this dude's about to take me out. Hebrews says it's appointed for a man once to die. I thought, this is my appointed time. I thought, this will be the last revival meeting I ever do. I'm not even teasing, dude. It was over for me. I was like, that's it. Here we go. My last chance to cast a net. Anybody need a miracle? It'll be short-lived, but let's go for it. Seriously, I was like, getting word of knowledge is last moments here. And your healing may last 3 minutes, but we're going to, I got to do some me thing. I got to get to heaven with some more things, but. So we landed. So we landed, and you know, it's like everybody. Ah! I'm like, what? We're still here? Then I felt kind of embarrassed. You know what I mean? Oh, yeah, it was me, a little frantic preaching. So we get off the plane, and they're like trying to give everybody free drinks, drunk them up. Drink, here's alcohol. Please drink as much. Forget this. Somehow let your mind forget this. They're giving everybody alcohol. I'm like, no. And then they're trying to give you like, here's $300. Like, yeah, right. We all just almost died. You gonna just, $300 is going to make it better? And they asked everybody on the plane, do you want to get back on a flight? And we landed at some emergency runway in Chicago. All of a sudden, everybody conveniently wanted to stop in Chicago. It was like, nobody got back on a flight. Nobody. I mean, everybody, oh, Chicago looks good today. And my wife looked at me and she goes, what do you want to do? I thought, woman, you better not even try to talk to me like this. Who are you talking to like this? I saw a window in the spirit begin to close. And the Lord said, you get back on that plane or you will have years of trauma to try to overcome what you just been through. if I don't get on that plane to preach the gospel, I open up myself to the devil and torment and never going back on a flight again. I don't have time for this. I said, we're getting back on that plane. I don't care if we die again. I said, I don't care, please. Don't matter what happens at this point. The day can't get much worse. Do you follow what I'm saying? If it takes a turn, I'm in heaven. I said, I don't care if we die on the next one. We're going to New York, and I'm going to Toronto, and I'm going to California, because this is what I'm called to do on this earth. It's great you amening my near death story. Do you know what I mean? All of you are getting laughs on my life almost ending, weirdos. But I get back on the, it's not funny. I get back on the plane, and I realize that most believers don't get back on the plane. They dwell. They ask why. They allow themselves to be moved by things on this earth. And if you live there, you now have opened the door to trauma because you don't feel like you have earthly answers. Fear has one goal, and it's to stop you from what God has called you to do. So you got a grandmother died of cancer, your mother died of cancer, your sister died of cancer, and what? You live and bow down to that devil, you'll have it. But if you put your foot down and say, absolutely not. It will not touch my family by the blood of Jesus. Guess where cancer can't come? And so we've got to live in a place on the offensive. We're not defensive people. We don't live by default. We don't, my day's not dictated. You know, is it, and even your life. Don't wake up in the morning and let text messages dictate your day. You turn your phone on and now your day's gone because somebody else is taking your attention. You control the day. You're not in my world unless I allow you to get in it. It's living offensively and then realizing that nothing just happens. There is no accident on the planet. If I'm in a gas station at 2 a.m., there's a reason I'm there. No matter where I am, no matter what goes on, I don't even have time to stop and wonder why, because I'm so after what we're called to do. So getting on, you've got to get back on the plane in your life, no matter what it is. It's personal revival. It's not corporately. My goodness. Honestly, the atmosphere here, I could snap my finger and heaven's here. I mean, it's easy because it's been plowed by the men of God. But I want to know your life on Tuesday at 2 o'clock.
Right.
Or when you get the bill, or you get the unexpected debt, or you get the phone call, or something tragic goes on to people around you. And how you respond are tests of your faith. And if we can overcome the tests, then you will see the suddenlies. And at that moment when she asked me, do I want to get back on the plane? I probably wouldn't want to if I thought. But I couldn't even ask myself the question. Like I wouldn't even trust myself to talk to that, because that's not who I am. Because all I'm going to do is ask the devil.
Right.
That is not God's best for me. You know, I think I told you last time, you know, you go to the Orlando airport and they like ask you how your experience is. Like hit the button. It's like, don't ask yourself those things.
Right.
If I went around introspectively all day long, kind of like weirdly inside, how do I feel? You're never going to feel good. The only person in there is the devil in your thoughts. Do you understand? But you live by faith. I love my wife with every single fiber of my being. But I don't wake up every day looking for just a feeling. I've made a choice and a covenant with this beautiful woman I spend the rest of my life with. But I'm not after some, you know, sensations there. But when it's not, I don't question my commitment to her. It's faith. It's belief. It's plowing. It's committing. It's knowing so deeply that we don't make those choices. But most believers don't get back on the plane. They just remember what happened to them and they're like, oh man. And then the minute you don't get on the plane, now you have to deal with all this, which can be broken in a moment. You need to realize this.
Amen.
Trauma can be broken in a moment.
Thank you, Lord.
And you never have to go back to thoughts. You never have to have those feelings. You can stand on that kind of truth. In Luke 19, the disciples asked Jesus. They asked the Lord how they could see the kingdom now. The truth is they were looking for an established kingdom. It couldn't come fast enough for them. And it says in verse 11 of Luke 19, as they heard these things, he spoke another parable because he was near Jerusalem and because they thought the kingdom of God would appear immediately. So they're asking the Lord, how do I see the kingdom now? So many believers I talk to, they want to know, how do I see the kingdom now? How do I demonstrate the gospel now? How do I see breakthrough now? You know, we live in this moment where it can't come fast enough. We demand answers and we want it today. And it's not a bad desire. I desire everything today. I'm always looking for it. And Jesus' answer is pretty crazy. He starts talking to him about a parable. This is the Lord's response on how to see the kingdom right now in your life. Therefore, he said, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. So he called 10 of his servants, delivered to them 10 minas, and said to them, do business until I come. But the citizens hated him and sent delegation after him, saying, we will not have this man reign over us. And so it was when he returned, having rescued the kingdom, he'd given the minas and called to him that he might know how much each man had been gained by trading. Then came the first, saying, master, your minas earned 10 minas. And he said to them, well done, you good servant, because you were faithful with very little. I'm going to give you authority over 10 cities. The second came, said, master, your minas earned 5. He said, you also will be 5 cities. Another came saying, master, here's your mina, which I've kept away in a handkerchief, for I feared you, because you're an austere man. You collect where you didn't deposit, reap where you didn't sow. And he said to them, out of your own mouth, I'll judge you, you wicked servant. You knew that I was an austere man, collecting where I deposit, reap where I didn't sow. Then why didn't you even put it in a bank that at my coming I may have collected it with interest? And he said to those who stood by, take the mina from him and give it to the one that has 10. But they said, master, he has 10 minas. And I say to you that everybody that has will be given from him. Who doesn't have even what he has will be taken away from him. But bring here those enemies of mine who don't want me to reign over them and stay before him. Jesus, they're asking a real legit question about the kingdom. How do we see it now immediately? And Jesus goes into this parable about the minas. And he says, every single one of you have been given a deposit. And how we handle that deposit, I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about the anointing. I'm talking about the Holy Spirit. And it's so interesting to me because self-preservation is demonic. See, religion gathers around the one that's putting it in a handkerchief. And we go, ooh, you're wise. You're wise. Let me tell you about the realm of faith. There is no increase when you self-preserve. The increase only comes in the go.
Right.
But somehow we've built a philosophy that wisdom is containing and hovering, and that's actually a poverty mindset. And here we see in one scripture the difference between process and suddenly. It is the only time I've ever found in scripture where somebody has been promoted instantly from one mina to a ruler over 10 cities in a moment. I mean, I'd say that's a big day of promotion. That's a suddenly. But we have a generation that cries out for the suddenlies, but they've neglected the process. See, there's this process of doing business till I come. Making ourselves ready. I feel, not just financially, I feel an obligation to steward the things of God.
Yes.
To eagerly desire the gift of prophecy, to go after signs and wonders. I feel a fire in my soul to see the things of God advance on this earth. It's the process before the suddenlies. And the danger here is we are so enthroned with the suddenlies of this ministry and what God is doing around the earth. But that's come through process. But if you are going to see the suddenlies in your life, not just attached to the suddenlies here, which we all are, but if you are going to see the suddenlies in your personal life, and you're going to be a ruler over 10 cities, then you better understand the process of every day. And you better understand the giving and the daring to dream and the stepping out in faith and the opening your mouth when God gives you the nudge and whatever it is. Because the Bible says that the things that we see on this earth are temporary, but the things that are unseen are eternal. That we've got to fix our eyes on things above, not on the earth beneath. And it's the trading that goes on every day in the supernatural, which is going to provide the 10 cities when God releases that over our lives in seasons or whatever he has for us. But I realize that so many people neglect the process. They just want the 10 cities, but they don't want to do business till I come. Jesus is not on this earth anymore. He's put you in charge of his mandate. It's a big responsibility. He's given you the work over his hands. And if we don't see ourselves differently, then we're not going to be able to do it. I'm talking about you thriving, not just the front row. You know what I mean? You thriving in life. And that prophetic song you guys sung, you know, it reminded me of Genesis 28, right? It was a Jacob, and he got up and he said, surely, you know, I didn't even recognize the presence of God. And he says, now this is none other than the gate of heaven.
Right.
He called the presence a gate. At our house, we have a swimming pool and we have like two fences, but we're getting a new fence built probably next week, 450 feet. There was a windstorm, took my trampoline, blew my fence out and knocked a neighbor's house. Time for a new fence. So this week, while I'm here, they're putting a new fence up, but I had to put a gate up. And the gate is in the back corner of the property. And when you go out of the gate, it takes you from the land I possess into the land out in the street that I don't possess. But a gate is an access point from one world to the next. Yes. Jesus had an open heaven that never closed. So do we, right? When he was baptized, the Father said, heaven's opened, right? You're my well-beloved son. They never closed since. And we have the same access. So if we're going to believe that the presence of God is the very gate of heaven, and we're going to believe that Jesus Christ was the gate of heaven, then I'm going to believe that the gate of heaven exists where Jesus is right now, which is inside of you.
Right.
So the mindset is that you are the gate of heaven.
Right.
That you are the entry point into another dimension. That through you is one world going into the next. That's what process is. It's that prophetic song you sung. All I think is the gate. You are the very gate of heaven. And don't be the one that doesn't recognize it. You know, you can be in a meeting. It blows my mind, man. I can see, I'm in miracle meetings, and there'll be a sick person just sit there like they might as well be watching TV. They're so checked out, they don't even have, they don't know what's going on. Jesus Christ stand right in front of them, they'd be like, who are you? But then someone right next to them, two people. Someone right next to him recognizes, believes, heals, runs. God touches him. It's possible for God to be moving and you not even recognize it. We've got to have our awareness heightened. Every day I want to be aware of his presence. Every day I want to be aware of what he's doing in our midst and where he is. And that's how we're equipped and transformed. Because you are the gate of heaven. You are the portal on this earth into another dimension. You're the access point for the unseen realm. It's actually you. It's nobody else. And when we see ourselves that way, then we'll believe that we're more than overcomers. And then we won't be so tied down to minimal things like sickness and poverty. That's the, you know, the Bible, Jesus said the financial part is the least of the kingdom. That when we build upon that, then we're stepping into different realms. Prayer, when you believe, you know, you change your posture in prayer from, you know, begging and pleading. And, you know, we pray on Friday nights. You know, we have, and I told our church, I said, listen, we're not going to do a prayer meeting the way you've been praying for 20 years. It doesn't work. Your prayers aren't answered ever. Like, I don't want you praying for me ever. Your prayers aren't effective. Like, who in the world wants to be a part of a prayer meeting that the answers don't ever come? You're like Rhoda in Acts 13. You know what I mean? He was in prison. They're praying for him to get out of prison. He gets out of prison and comes to the door. and they go, oh, it's a ghost, it's his ghost, and they're still praying for him to get out of prison. That's most prayer on the earth right now. You're praying for things that have already happened. You're begging God to do things that he's actually equipped you to do. And I told our prayer team, you are not going to pray from this lowly position begging. I said, no. You want to have a prayer meeting on Friday nights? It's going to be declaration of his word. You are going to decree a thing and let it be established. You're going to stand from a place of faith and declare the word of the Lord on this land. No one is going to pray from beneath. We are done praying as like you're a tail. You pray as the one of authority and power that God has called you to pray. You pray as if the angels are beneath you. And then you see results. Because you've changed your posture and your belief in prayer. But if we don't understand the power we have, then we're never going to be effective.
Never.
I think you guys got a pretty big zoo here. We have like a cheesy one. So they got these like depressed looking elephants in our zoo. I mean, they're just lame excuse for animals, man. These things are sad. They just slump over. They're just like, oh yeah, this is SeaWorld, right? I watched your documentary on Netflix. The dorsal fin because you killed the sea, whatever, the Shamu. Aren't you the bad ones who was San Diego, right? Yeah, I know you're gonna get all weird about animals. Listen. So these elephants are a lame. They can't even move. They're just so sad. Their ears don't flap anymore. I mean, they're just lame, dude. And I'm like, but the people that are around the elephants, they have like this stick that has like a flat like butt part, and then it has like a piercing. And I'm like, first of all, these elephants are like need healing, number one. I'm like, they barely move. Why do you have that stick next to you? And the woman's like, look, they're caged. So they're not even in their natural place. So they're just depressed in a cage. But they're still elephants. So if they decide to move, and I'm between a wall and this 4,000-pound beast, I'll either die, or I got to put the butt against the wall and jab him with the knife, and he backs off. I thought, what? Like, for me, it was like the perfect picture of religion. You were made to raise the dead. You were made to walk on water. You were made to command elements. You were made to live in the most extreme realms of the supernatural. But when we cage you up in places like churches, you just done. It's like, who, you don't even know who you are. You just walk around like, yeah, amen. But meanwhile, the devil's like, knows how powerful you are. Because at any moment, you know what I'm saying? These animals, I'm not against caging animals. I'll go to your weird zoo. You know what I mean? I like pandas. Cage the animals. I don't care. Do whatever you bring Shamu back with his dorsal. I don't care what you do. That's not my axe to grind. I don't care what you do to animals. But my point is, I look at them. But my point is, these beasts were made to roam. You could tell inside of them there's these instincts that were created like for Africa. They were created to like go for it, fight, kill, whatever the elephants do. I don't know, make noise, eat peanuts. I don't know what even they're supposed to do, but whatever they do, they're supposed to do it. But they're in boxes, man. In New England is the worst. It's like, weather's bad, come in the bedroom. I mean, these guys, there's no room like this. They're just like, just caged in together in the winter. But the Lord doesn't want you living caged. Not even in your mind, he doesn't want you living caged. Bible says, as a person thinks, so they are. I'm telling you that your life is a result of your thoughts. How you live every day is a result of your thoughts. And some of you just need to have to unlearn some things, man. Because you were taught wrong. Or religion put a lid on stuff. There's no lid. You follow what I'm saying? No lid. You can live holy. Sin will never have a hold on you. You can live in the supernatural, do everything God's called you to do. That's the standard of the kingdom for your life. And now it's the beauty of every single day living that out for the kingdom's cause. Can we stand, church? Can you guys come up for worship? I want to pray for you tonight. I feel an equipping. I feel that God is stirring. There's a process of increase that God is going to put on your life. Yes, there is. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Man, everything holding you back is going to be removed. I'm telling you, every obstacle, every distraction is not from God. It's from the hell. Man, I see God breaking trauma. Thank you, Lord, for a renewed mind in you. Thank you, God, that we are the righteousness of God in Christ. That whatever you've called us to do, we can do. I thank you that Satan has no power over our lives, over our minds, over our thoughts. Man, I'm telling you, I sense trauma. I feel that some of you have been through some real trauma. God wants to set you free. I see almost like a chain around some of your minds. Your thoughts have got, listen, it's all in the thought realm, man. It's all in the thought realm. As you think, you are, you become. But if your thoughts are not with his, then we can't have any other mind. But I feel like God, I almost see like a chain around people's minds. God wants to break those chains off your mind. There's a bunch of things I want to pray for, but if that's you, I want you to come forward. I want to pray over your mind tonight. Man, hell has no hold on you. This stuff's stopping you from your destiny, man. This ain't time to look pretty. It's time to get free. It might have been trauma like we experienced. It might have been a loss of a loved one. It might have been whatever lie it is from the enemy. God wants to set you free. And I want to pray for miracles tonight, too. But hold on. I'll call you up for that. As we begin to worship, let's just touch that realm in God tonight. Father, in the name of Jesus. Now, break every lie in the name of Jesus. Loose in the name of Jesus. Now, in the name of Jesus, we break every lie. In the name of Jesus. Now, I break those chains. In the name of Jesus. Now we break those chains. Every chain is broken. Now we break every chain. In the name of Jesus. Loose, we break every chain. Every thought is captive. The enemy's lying. I break it in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Freedom in the name of Jesus. Father, right now, I just release your love. I'll tell you right now, some with your father that God is going to heal. Man, I see a wound. Lord, we release it right now in the name of Jesus. Man, God is going to use you mightily. I'm telling you, you felt stifled creatively. God's going to change it. In the name of Jesus, we release it. Now. In Jesus, man, I feel healing. It's like healing over here. In the name of Jesus. Freedom, freedom. Now we release it, God. In the name of Jesus, we release it. Now we release it, God. Every chain broken in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Man, our thoughts have got to be his thoughts. In the name of Jesus, we break every lie of the enemy. Satan, you have no longer hold on her mind. We break it now. Loose in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Freedom, we release it, God. In the name of Jesus. Freedom in the name of Jesus. Loose in the name of Jesus. God, we declare freedom in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We declare restoration in the name of Jesus. Now we release it, God, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Man, I feel a notable miracle in this room right now. I mean, like, legit. If there's somebody here with either cancer, leukemia, how about this? If you're here with in the natural, they're telling you is an incurable disease, I want to pray for you. Who am I talking to? This one. You mark my words, you're going to see some crazy stuff come out of this. Man, it's all Jesus wants to do in your life. You've all said, I'm doing nothing. It's already been paid for. What's your name? Can you say what you need a miracle for? Your thyroid. Come on. Let's stretch our hands. In the name of Jesus, we just curse every attack on her thyroid. We command it to be restored. We break the power of hell off of her. Now we release the healing in her body. What does she need? Hey, let's stretch our hand. What's her name? Alina, she was born with Down syndrome. Let me tell you something. I just saw a vision of her preaching the gospel. I mean, like a woman with a dress over the word of God preaching. Alina, you're going to be healed, baby. Father, in the name of Jesus, we curse the report of the doctors. We curse Down syndrome, Satan. We break your power off of her life. We release a new mind, a new spirit right now in the name of Jesus. We release the fire of God upon her now in Jesus' name. Whoa! Look at her eyes. How old is she? She's 8. Look at her eyes. Something happened when she fell backwards. I'm telling you, I saw her on a stage with a flowing dress, preaching over the word of God. Huh? You saw the same thing. Are you, Mom? I want you to look for every sign tonight. And I want you to give God glory. And if it's complete, which I believe, then you tell us immediately. But this is notable, man. I mean, don't look for the signs you want. Look for, I mean, anything different. You'll know the way she's talking, even her kind of her cool little attitude, all that can mean something to you. You'll see something come out of her differently. You'll see her communicate. It's going to be a testimony, man. Man, what's your name, sir? James. Great name. You know, I think I just see you, man, you've known the Lord for a while. And I saw a radical young guy, man, that just was crazy and going forward. And somewhere along the lines, the enemy's tried to put that person away. And I think this kind of worn on you a little bit, you know, and almost put that fire out. And I feel like God is saying, it's time to relight that fire again. Yeah, thumb up for that, huh, honey? Because you're radical, man. And you're... You know, when you stand for something, man, that stubbornness you have, when it's for the kingdom, it's unstoppable. And Father, in the name of Jesus, we just release hope over James again on this family. God, that he's going to step into that place. He's going to wear the coat that you've pulled him to wear. I thank you that you've called him to your ministry, that he's going to stand for you. Many will be transformed by his story in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. What do you do for a living? Interesting, because I felt like a promotion's coming to you. But it's not going to stop anything that you're doing for the kingdom. If anything, it's going to be your heart for the kingdom that brings promotion. Look, it's what Pastor said this morning. When you chase, people say, oh, I'm gonna go for this job and it's going to be for the kingdom. It never works that way. It's always your kingdom seeking first, and then money just comes. And it's always those, James, as you're seeking the kingdom, as you make these priorities the same, you're like, you know what? I'm going to go for it. Look, I challenge you to spend 15 minutes a day, half hour, whatever it is, making more time for the Lord, making more room, letting that fire burn. Promotion will come because your focus is the kingdom. So, Father, I thank you for the increase on this family in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Anybody else for healing for an incurable disease? Yes, come up, please. Why incurable disease? Because I want notable miracles. Man, I'm so tired of the devil. Who are we praying for? Huh? Autism. Which one? Both of them. Come on, let's stretch our hands. Let me tell you, it's a lie from hell. It does not exist in heaven. Do you understand me? Father, in the name of Jesus, I just curse every label that this world has tried to place on this boy, and we just say he does not have autism. I break the lie of the enemy. I break the power of hell in the name of Jesus. And I tell you, son, you are free. You do not have autism. I declare the word of the Lord over you. You are sound in your mind. Your emotions have been wired by the Holy Ghost, and we release it now in Jesus' name. I break the lie of the enemy upon you. And young man, I declare that you are sound in your mind and your emotions and your spirit. You have been wired by the Holy Ghost, and we release it in the name of Jesus. Now, let me tell you this. I had a woman call me one time, and she said, my daughter's suicidal. She's in a padded room, and I need you to come pray for her. They said she's not going to make it. Whatever. They labeled all this jacked up stuff. You know, there's no bipolar and autism in John G. Lake's day. You know what I mean? It's like the devil keeps adding stuff to try to, like, get you upset. And she said, well, she's suicidal. She's bipolar. She's blah, 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 blah. She's in a padded room. And I want you to pray for her. And I thought I was going to exorcise these devils or something. The minute I walked on the property, the Lord said, she is not any of those things. I've actually given her a gift of discernment. And a gift to hear in the spirit. And because the world has labeled her, she bought into the lie of the demonic prophecy. Meaning she was never messed up to begin with. But the more people keep saying it's autism and it's this. And then you actually, it's a demonic prophecy waiting to be received. And over time you go, well, maybe, okay, I take that. And it was never yours to pick up. And the Lord said, you go in that padded room and you tell this young woman, you are not these things, and you are gifted and you have a spirit of discernment, and God is going to use you in the prophetic, and it will fall off of her. And I walked in the padded room. I said, girl, let me tell you something. You are none of, I mean, she was manifesting it, you know, just acting weird like she's a Miss Devil. I'm telling you, it was not even a devil. It was in her head because they labeled her and she received it. You know, somebody tells you you're something, you'll start to walk in it. And I said, I canceled the contract. And I tell you that you're this. I'm telling you, instantly the girl changed. She came right out of it. She was like, oh my goodness, I'm free. And I tell you the same thing over these boys. I cancel the contract. In the name of Jesus. Man, I mean notable miracles, man. You're going to see notable miracles from tonight. Because we cancel the contract. And whatever the lie the enemy has spoken over your body, lift your hands if you need a touch in your body. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just release your presence. Come on, it's the presence in this place. I release your healing power. And in that mighty name of Jesus, I curse arthritis. I curse diabetes. I curse every accident, shoulder conditions, back conditions. I curse cancer. I curse every sickness and disease. And by the blood of Jesus and by the power of God, I cancel every contract. I release it now. I curse all pain. I curse all lies now in the name of Jesus. Just move your body. I'm telling you right now, there's an atmosphere in this room. Come on, I feel the presence of God tonight in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for your presence. God, we're changed in your glory. Man, I feel promotion spiritually for you, church. God is bringing you to another place. He's teaching you how to thrive. Where God has taken this place, you've got to go higher. And he's training you to do it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just lift your hands to heaven. Oh, man, I feel a song brewing. Y'all are amazing. Come on, let's just worship. Come on, just lift up your voices to the Lord. Oh, you're worthy, God.
I want everybody to realize tonight that the armory is open. Come in, grab the weapons. Grab the divine abilities. Lay hold of, take hold of the mantle of the Spirit. Take hold of the mantle of the living God. Take hold of the word of knowledge. Take hold of the discerning of spirits. Take hold of the word of faith. Take hold of the miracle working power of God. Take hold of a good confession. Take hold of an authority that allows you to move in every dimension of divine power. There need not be another day of pain or sickness or disease or torment or lack or deficiency. There need not be another day of spiritual weakness and inability. Not another hour. An agreement with Father's word in the name of Jesus. An offering of your life unto Him. a yieldingness to the Holy Spirit, God will come and fill you right now. Let him come and fill you right now. Let him come and fill you. Let him come and fill you right now. This is the life that we live, to be continually filled with the Spirit. This is the life that we live. Hallelujah. Signs and wonders now. His miracles are here. God is moving in this place. His signs and wonders now. His miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in this place. The signs and wonders now. Your miracle is here. God, the Holy Ghost is moving now. Everything be changed right now in Jesus' name. The Holy Ghost is moving right now. Signs and wonders here. The miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in this place. Signs and wonders here. The miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in this place. His signs and wonders now. His miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in this place.
Lay hold on God. Lay hold on God. Lay hold on life. His eternal life is here. Oh, lay hold on God. Lay hold on God. Lay hold on God. His eternal life is here. Signs and wonders now. The miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in this place. It's yours now. Signs and wonders now. The miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in this place. The signs and wonders now. The miracles are. The Holy Ghost is moving in my life. The Holy Ghost is moving in my life. Oh, signs and wonders now. The miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in me now. Lay hold on God. Take hold of God and lay hold on life, His eternal life. Lay hold on God, take hold of God, lay hold on life, His eternal life. Lay hold on God, take hold of God. Lay hold on life, His eternal life. Lay hold on God, take hold of God. Lay hold on life, His eternal life. Lay hold on God, take hold of God. Lay hold on life, His eternal life. The miracles are here. Signs and wonders now. The Holy Ghost is moving in this place. Signs and wonders. The signs and wonders now. The miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving. He's moving in my life. Signs and wonders now. The miracles. Signs and wonders now. The miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving. He's moving in my life. Signs and wonders now. Hey, the miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving. He's moving in my life. Hey, lay hold on God. Lay hold on God. Lay hold on life. Oh, His eternal life. Lay hold on God. Take hold of God. Lay hold on life. His eternal life. Signs and wonders now. His miracles are here. Lay hold on God, take hold of God, lay hold on life, His eternal life. Lay hold on God, take hold of God, lay hold on life, His eternal life. Signs and wonders now, His miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Signs and wonders now, His miracles are here.
Push it. Press it. Press it. That's it. That's right. Press it.
Tomorrow morning when you gotta wake up and go to Monday. The Lord just wants us to push through, that no matter what it looks like, no matter what the atmosphere is around us, no matter what the world is saying, what the world is trying to push around us, that we push through, that when we lay hold on God, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter that the world's like, on Monday, we're like, no, this is an opportunity to show the love of God. This is an opportunity to set you free. So lay hold on Him by every thought, by every situation, by everything that comes up that looks like an obstacle, that looks like you can't, that's a lie that you can't, because God is in you and you can overcome it. You are an overcomer. You're more than an overcomer. That's who you are. You're more than an overcomer. So every thought, every emotion, every attitude, yield to God no matter what it looks like, no matter what it takes. Salvation, it's an eternal well. It has everything we need. It has life, it has healing, it has provision, it has salvation. Everything that we need is in this living water. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah.
You know, when James is praying for James tonight, I was thinking about when Sandy and James were in Colombia and doing their crusade, and James spit in a blind man's eyes, and the blind man saw. And the crowd increases dramatically when that happens. You know? But reality of it is, he had the divine unction to spit in the man's eyes. An unbeliever coming to check things out. You just don't do that to Hispanic people. To another man. Especially. One man comes up. Especially a Kringo. No, I'm going to say something, though. That's very important. The unction was there because you were bearing the responsibility of the meeting. It is so time that God's people start bearing the responsibility of the meeting instead of coming and, you know, standing around the fire, as Pastor James was saying tonight, and just watching the glory of God burn in one person's life. I know it might be very entertaining to watch, you know, these things of God as they manifest through us, but that's not what this is about. And I'm telling you, I believe what James didn't really fully get around to saying it, or at least to saying it fully. But I'm telling you, I am absolutely certain of a suddenly, where all of a sudden you're laboring with the things that God has faithfully given you. We've labored faithfully with the things of this ministry and this church. And suddenly, you just have a little bit and it turns in, a few pennies turn into rulership over 10 cities. I mean, it's huge. You know, and we're standing here in the presence of God, and the presence of the Lord is so rich and so wonderful, and we want to push the miracles now. We want to push the signs and wonders now. I'm going to tell you right now, that's Father's department. We stand and proclaim them. We stand and be confident in what God said He's going to do. Do you know something? If Father was to in any way not come through or renege on any dimension of the promises of His covenant, it would make the whole covenant void and none effect. any dimension of the promises and the blessings of the covenant, if he were to renege on them and not fulfill them, it would invalidate the whole of it, and he's not going to do it. He's not going to disregard the covenant and the blood that was poured out at Calvary's cross. And I want you to get so confident about this. People are acting like somehow God has reneged on the terms of the covenant, that he's withholding in the terms of the covenant. He's not. You and I need to bear the responsibility of what he sent us to do in the covenant. We're not waiting on God. He's waiting on us. And as we wait on him, as we continue to do what we're doing, do not weary in well-doing. Do not become faint-hearted in anything that God has given us to do. I mean, just shout it louder. I mean, I heard such a word this morning coming from my spirit. I hear it coming again right now by the Spirit of the Lord. Father is shouting over us. He's rejoicing over us. He's shouting shouts of joy over us. I want you to hear it. And then whatever it is that has tried to distract you, sidetracked you, whatever sickness or disease or torment or lack or unrealized desire or passion or vision or whatever the thing could be that the enemy's trying to torment you with, suddenly it becomes a non-issue. Because you'd be raptured over in a realm of faith, contending for the faith. Raptured over in a realm of beholding this wonderful grace that Father has poured out upon us, this wonderful thing that God has done in us. Hallelujah. Say it's done. Father did it. Instantaneously. As soon as you agree. As soon as you agree. Say, as soon as I agreed. As soon as I agree. People are going to come around you and they're going to start try to minister to the lie. They're going to try to minister to the things that are contrary to what God has said. They're going to try to remind you of the problems that you have and the issues you have, and Satan's chief of it. It's just time that you cut those people off in your life. You cut those communications off. I mean, how many times has God got to tell you it's not true? Okay, it's time to believe him. Listen, I want you to do something that is superior to the natural. Something that God the Holy Ghost is in right now. He's always asking us to do things with him. And you want to have a sensitivity to hear his voice and move with him. And so right now, I want you to just get an offering ready, and I want you to participate in sharing and communicating with your finances, because it's something that's beautiful to the Lord. It's a sacrifice that's well-pleasing to him. It's something that he delights in. It's something that he's required of us, and it is when we respond to him in it, it blesses him, and he blesses us in turn. So just come worship the Lord with your giving. Just come. If there's anybody, I don't want anyone leaving here tonight. We don't want anyone leaving here tonight without a miracle, without confidence that the miracle's happened. So if you need us to pray with you more, yes, dear. So just listen to this, because it's important to say, just tell them what happened.
For a few months, maybe 4 or 5, I was dealing with pain in my hips. 9 years ago, I lost the insurance, praise God. And I paid the fine with the government for not having insurance, but God is a provider. When the man of God said arthritis, the pain. I came with pain. And every day, and my children are witness that every day we command that thing to go. And I have not told anybody. I have not come to the altar. Every time Pastor Mark said, if I was sick, I wouldn't tell anybody. And I said, I'm going to do exactly that. Because the enemy of our soul is listening. So I wanted to let the man of God know what happened. Because tomorrow, he's going to wait for me to see what I'm going to say and what I'm going to believe. When Pastor Anaconda came, the Lord healed me from blood pressure. And he came like a lion trying to lie to me. That was 2005. And I have no problem with blood pressure. My blood pressure is 110 over 62 in Jesus' name.
And the arthritis, the pain, the arthritis left. It left immediately as soon as he said it. As soon as he was rebuking it. Yeah.
So believe if you came today and you came to the front for a healing, you receive it, whatever it was. The Lord healed me 2008. Pastor Mark, I went to the doctor for a physical and I came out sick with the thyroid. And I told the lady, I'm going to get a miracle. I believe what the pastor says when I go to church. And I came and it was Resurrection Sunday. And I told Pastor Mark, I told him the whole thing, how it happened. And he said, never again. And that's all he said. Never again, the anointing. And I went home and I received, and I lost insurance. That was 2008. 6 months later, I went to the doctor and they did a test. And they called me 3 days later and she said, everything is fine. Don't take the medication. You're fine. And I let the person say whatever she wanted to say. And I said, can I tell you something? Can I tell you a secret? She said, what? I have never taken the pills. What pills? The one for the thyroid. But you're fine. Your numbers are good. Did you know that you're going to take that medication for the rest of your life? And I said, you know what? When you called me Kimberly, I didn't say anything to you. But I made up my mind that I believe in healing. I serve a great God. That's what I said. And she said, can you repeat that again to me? So I told her the whole story again. And she said, well, you do need to come back in about 6 months and see Dr. Marco. And I'm going to make sure, I'm going to let him know. 2008, I'm fine in Jesus' name. Believe in your miracle. You received the miracle today.
You know, I just feel so, I love it because, you know, when people are testifying of what God's done for them, there's such an anointing, you know, in the house. Such an anointing of his goodness. Father, I mean, we're supposed to declare his deeds among the nations. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I mean, I promise you don't want to leave the house without giving thanks to Father for the miracle that's been worked, been wrought, hallelujah, in your life. Because the reality of it is the signs and wonders are here. The miracles right now. Signs and wonders now. The miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in this place. I thought baby was running up to declare the goodness of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. 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 We pray in the name of Jesus that from this day forward, all you will know about you is Christ Jesus is in you. All that you will know about you is who you have been created to be in him. That all those other things that belong to the realms of self, this natural life, will cease to have any dominion over you, any sway in your life. You live this out. Just come on, live this out. Because I promise you, what Father is preparing you to do, you do not want to miss out on any dimension of it. It's just glorious. It's big. It's huge. Hallelujah. It's exciting. It's heaven. Hallelujah. And no one's left out. No one's excluded. Everybody, would you stand with me? I know you're ready for another 2 hours. I know it. Hallelujah. You know, there's people that are staying up on the East Coast late at night, even in down in Florida and Mississippi and other places overseas and whatnot. Just turn around and wave at them. Tell them you love them. Hallelujah. We love you. Everybody, we love you. Find somebody around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' mighty name.